Have you ever wondered why the internet is radically different from previous media? I know that almost everyone here is an internet user, but in the next 15 minutes, I want you to think about the internet from a slightly different perspective that I guess almost most of you have never considered before. I call it network self-determination. And to understand what I mean, we have to start by what is the internet and why it has been so disruptive over the past decades. So what is the internet? I think you may already know that it is a network of networks. All the networks that compose the internet are interoperable. They can exchange freely information. They create global connectivity. So it means that regardless of who you are, regardless of where you live, of what company is selling you internet access, the internet has been designed to allow you to access and to share whatever content, whatever service, whatever application you want. And this is the first great difference between the internet and what we had before. If I want to send to you a picture from Rio de Janeiro, I do not have to ask any permission to anyone. And actually, you can also understand that Rio de Janeiro is a quite enjoyable place. And likewise, if you want to develop a new service, a new application, you are free to do so. You can plug it to the internet, and right after you put it online, all the connected individuals in the world can access and use it. And that is dramatically different from what we had before. Think about broadcasting. The broadcaster is the one that selects and chooses what you can watch, what you can listen to. In the telephone network, you can make voice calls because the network has been designed to make you do voice calls. The internet is different because we are not mere consumers. We are prosumers. We can produce innovation. We are not limited to consumption. And therefore, we have the power to shape the evolution of the internet through our imagination, through the fruit of our creativity, is what can define the evolution of the internet. And the internet has been designed to allow us to do so. It has been designed with an open architecture, an empowering architecture that decentralizes the networking experiences in the hands of the users. But this open, free, user-empowering architecture is not something immutable. And that is something that we have to keep in mind. And actually, over the past 20 years, there have been many attempts to modify this architecture for one simple reason. If you are a prosumer, if you can generate innovation, you may be a risk for established players. Because if you produce a new service that disrupts the business model of the established player, you're a risk. If you're a simple consumer, you may be a reliable source of income for the rest of your life if the established player managed to make you their user. And one very important thing has been realized by almost every player in the internet ecosystem, which is that your attention is the most valuable resource online for one simple reason. Your attention means data, and data means money. When you spend time on a specific service, on a specific application, the provider is harvesting your data. He knows what you are doing, who you are, what you like, what are your psychological weaknesses. And they can define a very precise profile of you. They can understand, foresee, and shape through advertisement what you will buy, what you will watch, what you will listen to, what you will vote. And those who have the capability to exercise this power can earn incredible profits. And this is why there has been a scramble for data over the past 10 years. All major players are trying to harvest your data and to concentrate your attention on specific services. And data are so valuable that they have been compared to the oil of the 21st century. Perhaps you have already heard about it. But data are much more lucrative than oil. Because the oil, when you extract it, you sell it, you consume it, and it's burned, it's gone. When you extract data, you process data, you refine data, you keep on processing them, potentially forever, and with multiple uses, and keep on extracting revenue. And you keep on doing so if you have no limitations. And as you may imagine, every time in history a new, very lucrative resource has been discovered, those who have the knowledge to understand the value of the resource, those who have the financial capability to try to dominate it, are trying to do so, are trying to subject those who produce the resource. And guess who is the producer of data? The users. It's you. And this is precisely why, over the past 20 years, there have been many examples of network operators, internet service providers, that tried to shape, to predefine how you can use the internet. So this is a particularly common behavior in those operators that have market power and that vertically integrate with content producers, that have partnership with content producers. And this is what has sparked the network neutrality debate. Net neutrality is a term that has been coined by Tim Hu from Columbia University, and many academics, many advocates, many startup innovators over the past 10 years have been advocating for it, because it is a principle of non-discrimination. Internet traffic has to be treated with no discrimination based on, on the commercial interest of the provider. The provider cannot say, I'm blocking this and I'm prioritizing my partner, because otherwise your rights are directly impacted. Your capability to innovate is directly impacted. Let me provide you a concrete example, Skype. Skype was a brilliant Estonian startup, and it could have been so successful as WhatsApp is today. But there is one key reason why it has not been so successful. It was blocked by mobile network operators for several years. And so if you cannot access an application, or if the application is degraded, so the quality is not good and you think that the application doesn't work, you will not use it. You will use something else, maybe what is prioritized by the operator. And again, this has a concrete impact on your freedom to communicate and on your freedom to innovate. And it is precisely why almost 50 countries in the world, you see them in blue, have already decided to protect net neutrality in the legal framework. They have enshrined the non-discrimination principle into regulation. So if you live in one of those countries, and if you live in an area where internet access is available and it's affordable, well, you have a fair chance of enjoying free internet connectivity. But what if you live in the other countries? And what if you live in an area, in a rural area, in an area where there is low income population and the operators do not have an interest in investing, bringing connectivity in that area because there is no return on investment? So what could you do? Well, you can build the internet yourself. And that is the second reason why the internet is dramatically different from the rest, because you can build it. And actually, there are many examples of group of people around the world that are building community networks. They literally build the infrastructure themselves, do-it-yourself connectivity. They set up antennas, routers, and they do not resign to be digitally marginalized. Those people want to be the protagonist of their digital futures. And they build connectivity for the community. So those networks that they built are free and open by design, and they respect net neutrality by default, because the provider is the community. So the greatest interest of the community is to have all the information possible, all the innovation possible, and actually to produce innovation to shape the internet evolution, because that innovation that they produce will be useful for the community itself. And there are many examples of this around the world, and this is precisely what I call network self-determination. Is the right to freely associate, to define in a democratic fashion the design, the development, the implementation of the new network infrastructure that will be managed as a common resource, so that everyone is free and able to receive, impart innovation and information. And you can see a nice picture of some of the founders of BARN, broadband from the rural north. They have built a fiber optic network in Lancashire, UK. It's a group of farmers and a hairdresser, actually. And they decided that they didn't want to be digital outcasts. They laid fiber, and now they provide connectivity to thousands of people, and they have internet speeds of up to 1 gigabit per second, which is actually not even available at NASA. And that is a point they always stress. And here's a picture of the community network Nuvem, close to Rio de Janeiro, where the NGO Qlab has helped the locals to build their own community networks. They were completely cut out of the internet, and now they enjoy connectivity, and they have also received ICT training. So besides having access to information, to knowledge, they've understood how the internet works. And they can build the internet, they can build services for the community, they can become entrepreneurs. Their life has dramatically changed because now they have opportunity they were completely cut off before. And community networks can be built by anyone, literally anyone, with a little training, anywhere. This is a picture of my friend Mahabir Poon. He has been developing community networks in the Himalaya mountains since 15 years. This is an antenna of the Nepal Wireless Networking Project. Thousands of individuals that were previously completely cut off the world, now they have connectivity, they have access to education, they have access to e-health. And this is a picture of the New York City Mesh, pretty cool community network in New York, where people do not have to worry if the government of the, or the legislator will repeal net neutrality provisions, because they have net neutrality. They have built their own network. Their internet is non-discriminatory, period. So those are some examples that let you understand that network self-determination is something that already exists in practice, in the facts. Evidence shows that people around the world are already enjoying network self-determination. But what is key to understand is that it is also built as a concept on your fundamental rights. You have the fundamental rights to freedom of association. You can freely associate. You have the fundamental rights to pursue your economic and social development. It's your fundamental right to self-determination. And you have the fundamental rights to freedom of expression. You can freely impart and receive and seek information and ideas. Those are your fundamental rights. They are yours. So you must have the right to network self-determination. You have the right to a non-discriminatory internet. You have the right to build the internet by the people and for the people. Thank you.